I'm a big believer in the origin story. We love stories about being something better than oneself. So I came from a love of that style of story.
I had such a buildup for Wonder Woman.
And cut, nice.
I got the part in 2012. I was so ready. Like, I had these months of me getting super excited about this character. I literally just wanted to attack, to give it a bite, to dive in. And the only thing that I cared about was telling Diana's story.
Be careful in the world of men, Diana. They do not deserve you.
To honor Wonder Woman in her first movie ever, it was fixating on how to best tell that kind of classic origin story. Really trying to celebrate and enjoy where she comes from and what that history is and that journey that every superhero must take into what it is to be a superhero.
This film has come along at a really good time for everyone to get perspective on how she sort of fits into pop culture.
What she stands for is so universal, and it's good. There's such goodness in her. And the character, even though she's had so many iterations since she's been around for over 75 years, those pillars of what she stands for remain constant. We felt a great responsibility to make sure that we brought Wonder Woman to the screen in the most honest way we could.
I am a fan of Wonder Woman, and so I do feel like I understand the material. And as somebody that understands Wonder Woman, loves Wonder Woman, the job becomes how do I, as a fan, stay true to what I loved and bring it into the modern era.
Bringing any character to the big screen comes with its own challenges. Wonder Woman specifically, I think the nuance of her character, the compassionate hero, is something that can get lost very easily. The guy in the alley that she knocks down, other superheroes would have a foot on his chest and said, okay, where's Ares? And the nuance really was like, we can't do that. That's not who she is. She would come by him and kneel down and say, I'm gonna help you, but tell me where he is.
Where will I find Ares?
It's a very subtle difference in the character. But that's the challenge of bringing her origin story to the screen, is really making sure that the character embodies everything that Wonder Woman is, because she's not just another character. She's an icon. She's Wonder Woman. And she means a lot to so many of us.
I think you come into something like this knowing that this is very personal to people, and their relationship with Wonder Woman is very personal to them. The most important thing to do is to live up to who is that woman who is so good and so strong and so exciting and so beautiful and funny and kind. That is what drew us all to Wonder Woman.
Patty and I had many creative conversations about this character, and her vision for Diana was in line with mine.
You were so good, you were even getting scared.
Gal has many qualities that actually epitomize what one would hope to find in the individual who plays Wonder Woman. She certainly has grace. She absolutely has courage. She has a lot of wisdom. She's humble and truthful. It was amazing to see her not just assimilate the part, but also imbue the part with her wonderful qualities.
Patty and Gal have really done an amazing job of looking into all the potential branches that make her who she is, making Wonder Woman, Wonder Woman.
The look of the film is one that I really believe in, because I think she deserves grand cinema, like a grand, epic tale of the times, but then we're injecting a lot of pop and modernity into the style to live up to how incredible she is.
It can stop the war.
War. What war?
Putting Wonder Woman into World War I is tough from a filmmaker standpoint, because our concept of a superhero, I think, is a very modern one. And then suddenly you're putting her into a period film. And that was our challenge, and really the challenge that Patty presented us with the entire time. So all of us were thinking about that, from the production designer to me, to the costumes, to visual effects, she had to be of that time and yet also beyond it.
And so how can we add modernity to this classic genre? The first thing was meeting with each of them and talking about, okay, here is the story that we are hunkering in on telling. Here's the direction and here is the tone that we're headed towards.
A lot of it was color combinations that you wouldn't see necessarily in World War I. More intense, more saturated colors than you'd normally see in a period film. We wanted modern contrast, so really rich blacks and really poppy highlights. Very early on, Patty and I talked about a portrait painter of the time of World War I, John Singer Sargent, and he actually had what we would consider a very modern approach to using light in his portraits, and a lot of that was very soft frontal three-quarter light that quickly fell into blackness beyond the character. And that painting style sort of dictated a lot of how I approached lighting the faces.
And John Singer Sargent had such a deep body of work of that period, beautiful paintings that we could turn to for the color palette that people were wearing then, black and brown and gray and blue and white.
I really have not been on anything that has had quite the insane breadth and depth of craftsmanship as this. We were doing one scene out in no man's land, and there's smoke at all times out there, and at one point there I saw blue smoke, and I turned to Patty and I said, well, does the blue smoke have any reference to anything in reality? She said, no. We chose the color of what the smoke would look like because it was going to read a different way on film and also interact with everybody's costumes in a certain way that I just liked, which I thought was extraordinary. You know, that's a potentially very small detail that many people would kind of brush aside that Patty is investing time and energy thinking about.
I had the driving attachment to it in the first place to help guide me in trying to do the movie that I would have wanted to see. And so that's the formula I was always working on. Does this feel like Wonder Woman? Is this a beautiful movie? Are we aiming as high as we can possibly aim? And how can this movie be honoring Wonder Woman and the story and all of the incredible artists who made this all possible?
On this, the inspiration, I've got to say, of the design of all of the armor and all of the world of Themyscira, I've tried to grow it out of the Wonder Woman costume used in Batman versus Superman. So taking all the style lines, taking all the information in that one costume inspired all of the others. So whether they're the queen or whether they're a soldier, there's a hint of the Wonder Woman costume in all of them.
I think what's lovely is what Lindy extracted from that and what's come through is there's sort of a kind of Aztec tribal yet slightly Art Deco motif, which I think what's lovely about it is that's actually quite an original thing to do as armor, let alone on girls. What the boys are up to now is they're basically blocking the leather down to make Queen Hippolyta's battle armor. It's all gilded, so it'll look highly metallic like the other pieces do for the infantry, army, etc.
Hippolyta has an eagle as an emblem. And this was, to me, perfect. I was so delighted because you see the actual Amazons, the actual female warriors of 2,500 years ago would train eagles to become their hunting partners. And so to me, having this emblem of this woman who was living 2,500 years ago and was hunting with this eagle and her horses, that to me was the splendid image of a woman living in the world on her own terms.
There were four or five very strong characters that we wanted to individualize, especially with the weapons and things. And it was a huge responsibility not to let it get too whimsical. It had to find its own place. By working really closely with Patty and Zach and Aline, that really helped me anchor how we would introduce different imagery into the shields or the swords. And we basically came up with a design that would go through each weapon.
This is the God Killer. This is Wonder Woman's weapon. So we had literally hundreds of designs for this before we got it down. But this was the chosen God Killer.
The serpent was chosen for Diana's sword. That animal was chosen just because of its look. It's fierce. It just gives off that vibe that they want her to be that way. It's a strong, fierce, and if attacked, will attack you back.
Lindy's costumes, Eileen's sets, when you arrive as an actor on a film, you prepare and you step into this environment that has been created for you, and your preparation is only increased by 100%. You walk onto the set, bathed in golden light, it streams through it, and you open a drawer and there's papers and documents inside the drawer. You look behind you and there are more test tubes and waters and things that are bubbling, and the detail is exquisite. It's like this rich tapestry, a tapestry where you don't see the stitching.
The challenge is finding the right shot that reveals the enormity of the bomb-making operation, not getting lost in all this sea of architecture. And then the trick is not making it look flat and uninteresting. But there's a lot of great colors and a lot of browns and charcoals and blacks already in the design.
When you start to make a set, you start to build a volume, and after that, you paint it, and after that, you dress it. And the detail at the end will bring all the sense to all the work which has been done before. And suddenly, Matt brings light, and all the characters arrive in costume with the makeup, everything. And suddenly, there is this magical moment where everything is all together and you are in the movie.
Shooting on location is amazing. Shooting in real landscape with real land, particularly because this took place in World War I.
We have got something in the region of 38 locations across two countries, across the UK and Italy. This is a recreation of the Armistice Day in 1918, and it's been a huge amount of work to get to this stage we are at today. It's fantastic. We have 400 extras, we have everyone in period costume. We shut the road network down for 3 hours in central London and closed down all the businesses around Trafalgar Square. The National Gallery are fantastic. They've helped us out immensely in trying to achieve what we have over here.
It's the same thing without dialogue. Everybody just really enjoy the moment, looking around, seeing different things.
We're in King's Cross Station. This will be Paddington Station in 1918. We've come here because a lot of the building works period-wise. The structure and everything we'll keep as is. We'll have to paint out lights and things like that. For the most part, we're getting a lot more stuff in camera, and it's more about cleaning up little things. You know, rather than shoot this on a stage and have to make the entire set, we can take advantage of what we can get here on location and use it to film.
We closed down two platforms for an entire weekend. We bought a period 1914, I think it was, vintage train. They'd never had a pre-First World War train on the network before, so that was challenging.
Everybody
looks
so great.
You look
Thank
great.
You guys so much for being here.
Spike bomb! Ready? And action!
Fresh ice cream. Hello, miss. Would you like to buy an ice cream?
Me?
Yeah, fresh ice cream.
It's yes. Really good. Thank you.
8 pence, please, sir.
There you go, pal. Keep the change.
Thank you very much, sir.
What do you think?
It's wonderful.
Yeah.
You should be very proud.
Patty really gave the film a very specific point of view, and wanted to make sure that even though we were dealing with a film about a superhero, that it was going to be unique. And her vision was embraced by this great team of people that we put together.
Patty tells us to see every scene through the eyes of Diana. How would this thing look if you're experiencing it through her eyes?
Is this what passes for armor in your country?
every scene has been imbued by that. It's a really refreshing, exciting way to approach a superhero film.
It has been wonderful to see the world through Wonder Woman's eyes. It's almost like some days were so bright. And so that, to me, has been wonderful because it has left me less cynical and maybe a bit more excited about things.
Often we'd find Patty sort of acting out the scenes from Wonder Woman's point of view before she would tell us what she wanted. She would kind of run around on stage and be Gal for a minute. Oh, and that's infectious, and that spread to all of us. Her sense of wonder herself, not only as a fan, but as a filmmaker, seemed to work hand in hand.
She really loved the story we were telling. It was someone that she grew up with and looked up to.
I feel so honored to be making a movie using a superhero who stands for something that important. And the 7-year-old in you, like, heart skips a beat and almost wants to cry because it's hitting that visceral note that you didn't even remember you had after working on something for so long. And you go, it's Wonder Woman!